Please give a warm welcome to the Indigo Trio.
I can never remember a time where the audience is screamed after. Like the old folk songs we play at, so they don't do that. So that's really nice. Thank you guys so much for having us. We're the Indigo Trio. I'm John. We've got Alyssa on cello. We got Jesse on violin. And I was just gonna ask, are any of you guys string players? Oh, wow, are any of you guys viola players? No way! Unreal. There's so few viola players around. I'm always happy when there's one in the house. So the voice you heard at the beginning singing, we start some of our shows with that piece. That's a recording that my brother found. I don't know if you guys have heard of Alan Lomax. He was a guy that went around with a microphone all over the world in like the 40s and 50s recording like folk song and like traditional song all over the world. So my great-grandfather was from a mining town in Wales, and my brother found that Alan Lomax had been recording in that town in Wales, and so we pulled it up, we found that song, and I never met my great-grandfather, but he was from that town, he was a miner from that same small town, so never heard his voice, but when we heard that, we're like, oh, that's probably what my great-grandfather sounded like. He didn't speak English, he only spoke Welsh, which is what you heard him singing in, so we're like, ah, we'd like to play with him, so we wrote that song to play along with my great-grandfather. And then we transitioned into, it's called a peat dance, arranged by the Danish String Quartet. I don't really know what a peat dance is. I think once you've harvested all your hay as a farmer, you do like this dance around it, and that's all we know about it. We like the music though, so that's why we play it. So next we're going to do a couple of arrangements of that I made of Shostakovich's Piano Preludes and Fugues. As a string trio, I don't know if some of you guys who play string instruments might know, we don't have a ton of string trio music. There's some standard rep, but it's small. So one of the fun things that we get to do as a trio is to go find our own music and arrange our own music. And so I've always loved these Shostakovich preludes. So I arranged a couple of my favorites. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Shostakovich or his life. He's like one of the most legendary Russian composers that ever lived. He's also one of the people that experienced like most intensely what like oppression from Russian government did. I don't know if you guys know about his life, but him and his family just saw like incredible suffering. And so in this music, you'll hear moments of like huge optimism, huge joy, but there's also something very deep inside that's like just deeply mournful in almost all of his music. So obviously that's something that we share with what we see going on in the world today. So hope you like these three preludes. I want to pause for talking to you. That's so nice. Thank you.
you so much. Hey guys, I'm Jesse. I am originally from Regina. Alyssa and I are sisters. I don't know if you guys can tell, but that we are. We're both from Regina and Winnipeg.
I'm Winnipeg.
John is from Winnipeg. I don't know if we mentioned this. So this next piece we're doing is one that we all love. It was a piece that brought us together actually initially. And I guess before I talk about it, I just want to share, like, as a trio, we go to a lot of smaller communities, smaller towns, as a in part to share classical music more. There's just there's not a lot of accessibility to it, but also to share the importance of classical music, which I don't know if you agree with this, but you know, it's less and less prominent. Like, you don't hear it on the radio like you hear your favorite pop tune, you know. And so for us as a trio, a huge part of outreach is sharing the context of the piece and understanding deeply what the piece means to us and to all of you, because I believe that Mozart is just as relevant today as he was when he was alive. When was the I dealt with this situation in the context of contemporary classical music, which growing up I actually strongly disliked. And I remember I actually studied at Mount Royal in my first year of university. I wrote an essay on how most contemporary music is not real art, and which I totally disagree with now. But what changed for me was understanding the context of what we were playing. So just with that in mind, this piece we're playing, it's called A Sanguine Clockwork. And sanguine means blood, just so you know, and you know what clockwork is. Paul Wianco, he's this incredible composer. You guys should absolutely look him up. Just to give you context of who he is, he's like the largest man you've ever seen, kind of a Hagrid-like character. With the longest hair, and he's definitely a metalhead, which you hear in his music. But he is also an incredible folk musician, as well as classical, as well as metal. And in this piece, he was trying to figure out what it is about folk music that connects each one of us. And why, when you hear a folk song, why does it feel familiar, even if you've never heard it in your life? And so in this piece, we're almost like in the laboratory with him as he does all these incredible or crazy experiments trying to figure out like the truth of this question. And so the two elements to listen for, it starts off with, have you guys ever heard of a Rube Goldberg machine?
Yeah?
Okay, nice. For those who haven't, have you guys ever played Mousetrap? Yes? Okay, couple. Essentially, it's like the idea that you like flick a marble and then it sets off a series of events that keeps setting off the next thing, and so it expands. And that's how this piece begins. There's a lot of metallic and clockwork-like elements throughout this as he's like trying to figure out, is it time that is the thing that connects us all? But the other side of it, the other part of the experiment that he's working with is the sanguine part. And there's a particular part in this, in the middle of this piece, where we hold a note for about like 30 seconds. And in this part, he told us that he wants us to check in with our body, check in with our breathing, like feel our heartbeat. And not just us as players, but also you as listeners. And in that way, we're all kind of connecting on the fact that we are all totally, completely present together with ourselves and with each other. So. Yeah, I hope you enjoy Sanguine Clockwork. I'm interested in your thoughts, so you can tell me after. All right, thanks. Thank you.
Thank you guys so much, and yeah, we're really interested to hear your opinions on that piece afterwards, because it's, as you guys might know, it's a whole different thing once we've worked on a piece and we've learned to love it, but we know it's also a little confusing on your first listen through, so interested to hear your thoughts after. Next, we're going to do another arrangement that I've done. Do any of you guys listen to Neil Young? Two people. Well, you guys are my favorite people in the room. And yeah, Neil Young is like a singer-songwriter that I grew up just like absolutely loving. And kind of like Jesse was saying, we grew up playing tons of classical music. And we still want to play, you know, music that we hear sung today. But we play these instruments, so we just have to arrange for them. So this is my arrangement of Old Man by Neil Young. Hope you like it.
I also studied in Calgary. I went to Mount Royal and
studied, well, actually, I was friends with Katrina, I can't remember her last name, who teaches a string program, so yeah, I'm sad she's not here, but oh well, I'm glad you guys are. So next we have a piece by Karen Sunabaka, and I'm sure, has anyone heard of her by chance? No? Okay, I hadn't either, but oh, there was a, oh my goodness, that's awesome. Yeah, she's from Manitoba, she lives in Ontario now, and she, well, me and Inutrio, we've only been together for about a year, we got a grant to have a composer write a piece for us. And so we were looking around, and Karen Sunabaka seemed like a perfect fit. She was looking into her Métis heritage in her music, and that, of course, involves Métis fiddle tunes. And in case you haven't noticed, we do like folk and fiddle and kind of blending that with classical, so we thought this is perfect. So we asked her, she would write a piece for us based on one or two fiddle tunes, and she agreed, and we got the grant, and because none of us are Métis, we were like, maybe we should work with some Métis fiddlers and learn the original tunes, which we were able to do. We met with two great fiddlers from Manitoba, and learn it by ear, which, like, when you're growing up and playing music, you learn everything by ear, it's super easy. But when you get old and you're like have all this music in front of you, it's actually surprisingly difficult. So it's humbling and wonderful. So this piece that she wrote, it's called A Reel Waltz. She based it off of a Winnipeg Reel and the Red River Waltz, both tunes that she grew up listening to on her grandparents' farm in Selkirk. And she's a cellist too, which makes her, I want to say even better, but I shouldn't say that, bias showing. But she took these two pieces apart and put them together in a really fun way. So you hear bits and pieces of both of them throughout the piece. We thought that like the Métis voice, we've never played Métis music or fiddle tunes before, so we thought it would be a wonderful opportunity to add some Manitoba Métis fiddle music into our program. Well, we hope you enjoy A Reel Waltz by Karen Sunabaka. This is our first time playing it in Alberta, so this is officially our Alberta premiere of it. She just wrote it a couple months ago, so here you go.
Thank you.
that right?
Yeah, I think so.
We haven't got the call from Spotify yet. No, maybe at some point, but no, not yet. Not yet.
How did you guys form this group? How did we form this group and, sorry?
How did you start working together?
I was living in Berlin, and I was going to move back to Canada and wasn't sure what to do because it was COVID. And I actually came across Prairie Debut, who are presenting us today. They were looking for artists who were close to home, and I was going to be home soon. So I contacted my sister and my friend John, and just wondered if they wanted to form. It was totally just kind of a random off-the-cuff thing, but it just turned out to be so much fun. And yeah, it's just been like really a wonderful year together. So yeah, just kind of one of those.
How did you guys meet John?
Good question.
Me and Jesse met during the summer. There's like different music festivals that are all over the place, and we just happened to end up at the same music festival in Halifax called
Scotia Fest,
which any of you string players should definitely go to. It's a great time for 2 weeks in Halifax, but we ended up in a trio there, so that's how we met.
And then I moved in to Winnipeg from Toronto, and John and I did a random gig at a countertop place.
There was like a function at a countertop, like marble store. And so we showed up, and they're like, there's a bunch of counters, and they're like, hey, go play between those counters for a couple hours.
So we did. So. And I didn't see him for like 3 years. And then Jesse did her thing.
It was a deep bond. Sorry. switching between very quickly. I think it's challenging, but it's, I think it'd probably be challenging with any piece that you go into, because there's a different headspace for every composer, and
Hey, like that Pulvienko piece is more about having fun and going like crazy, and like when you play something like Mozart, it's very much not that. It's sort of very much about being precise and making sure all the notes are exactly where they need to be. So it can be hard, but also I think we all do that enough that it's, you know, we can do that fairly quickly. It's still a challenge for sure.
Oh, sure. Yeah, sorry.
Why do you play the instrument that you do, or like why do you choose that instrument?
Why'd you choose viola?
That's a great question. I get asked that a lot. No, I played violin for like the first 50 years of my life, and my teacher at the time also taught viola. I tried her instrument out. I really loved it. It's one of those things where it's just like really impossible to explain, and if you try to explain it, it kind of sounds weak, but I just love how it sounds. And I love how it sounds, and you know, each instrument has a different role to play. And, like, violin takes a lot of melody and high stuff, and like viola and, or like cello takes a lot of bass line and low things, and viola kind of like goes around in the middle and fills out all the harmony and this kind of thing. And I like kind of violas just nodding. You kind of wiggling around in the middle spaces,
you know,
making them sound good.
Yeah, thanks, John. Yeah, I chose cello because I was small and it's big. I was so little when I started playing it that I actually don't remember. I think I heard it and my mom said that I like the sound of it, so I never stopped.
There were some questions.
One more question.
Okay, someone else
just like, well, we'll take one from the back so we can shout it at us later.
Yeah,
yes.
We'll be around.
Favorite piece to play together.
Favorite piece to play together? The Bianco is pretty crazy and fun to play.
Anything that goes fast, I think we like, you know? So, no. We like them all. We like them all differently, and if you play too much of, like, fast music, you end up being, feel like wanting to play a slow piece, so it always changes, too, you know? But, I don't know.
Yeah.
They're all our children. We love them all, you know?
We give them another piano?
Today. Thank you to Prairie TV for making this happen, and thank you all for being here today, because it is so important that this music is shared. We have about 1 minute or so until the bell goes, so I know that the foyer gets a little bit crazy, so we're going to ask that the music students in the front two sections just hang tight for a moment, and we'll have Ms. McKenzie and Ms. Blitz class, you're able to make your way out. Thank you so much for coming. And then Ms. Power and Ms. Rogers class can make your way out afterwards, just so that we don't storm the doors.